Ooh, this guy's taking the CELPIP exam, and he's doing the reading part of the exam. Now, on the reading test, there are four parts. The third part is called reading for information. You have 9 minutes to answer nine questions. Do you think you can do it? Well, in this lesson, I'm going to teach you how to do it. Okay, if you want more practice videos like this, I would be so happy if you subscribe to my channel right down there. Okay, so this question we're going to look at today is right from the CELPIP website. The CELPIP website is just celpip.ca. Okay, and you can actually get a free practice test on the website. So just go to the website and then you click open a CELPIP account. And I think you just have to put your name and your email address, and then you have a free account, and then you can access the free practice test, speaking, listening, reading, writing. So if you're going to take the CELPIP exam, you should definitely go check that out. Any practice is good practice, right? That's why you're watching this video right now. Okay, so in this question, you're going to see a reading passage that is broken down into different paragraphs, okay? A, B, C, D, right? And then you're going to see questions that look like this. The Siberian tiger is the world's largest cat. Okay, which paragraph was this information in? Was this information in paragraph A, B, C, or D? Or E, which means it wasn't in the reading passage at all. Okay, so you're going to have nine questions that look just like this, and you have to choose the right paragraph. Okay, so what do you think is the best strategy for answering this question? Well, I think the best strategy is to read the questions first because the questions are short, and then start reading the passage. Then, when you read something that is one of the questions is about, then you can just put it in there. Okay, so as you're reading all the paragraphs, then you can answer the questions while you're reading. I think that's the best strategy. That's how I would do it anyway. Okay, so this reading passage that we're going to look at today is about an animal called the narwhal. Okay, it's a real animal. It lives in Canada. It looks kind of crazy. It looks like a cross between a whale and a unicorn. A whale and a unicorn. I don't know. It's a real animal. Okay, so let's follow my strategy and read the questions first. Okay, so question one. There are physical differences between narwhal males and females. Okay, so we're going to try to remember, is there something in the passage talking about physical differences? Okay, narwhals are also referred to as death-like. There are aspects of narwhals' anatomy that remain unexplained. Narwhals present puzzling social interactions. Narwhal whales are connected to Canadian Aboriginal folklore. There is a sound understanding of narwhals' mating behavior. Different countries are documenting narwhal behavior patterns. Okay, the narwhal population is in jeopardy. Narwhals' physical characteristics are also observed in other whale groups. Okay, so there are nine questions. Now we can start reading the passage, and we're going to try to remember the questions. Okay, so here is paragraph A. The narwhal is an endangered type of whale found in the fr Okay, we can stop reading right there. We already have one of our answers. Okay, endangered type of whale. What does endangered mean? That means at risk. The narwhal population is in jeopardy. Okay, so we already have the answer to question eight. And so we pick A, paragraph A. Okay, so then we keep reading. Endangered type of whale found in the frigid waters of the Arctic, extending from Canada through the Norwegian waters to Russia. Narwhal means corpse whale, and it has earned its name because of its mottled dark gray color. Narwhals are regularly harvested for meat and ivory in northern Canada and Greenland. Okay, I want to stop and explain something very important to you right here. Look at that word, mottled. Mottled. What does that mean? Have you ever seen that word before? I haven't. This is the very first time in my life that I've seen that word, mottled. I have no idea what it means. Okay, so when you're taking the reading part of the CELPIP exam, you're going to see very advanced vocabulary that you've never seen before. And they do that to test your problem-solving skills. Okay, now in the reading passage, when you see a word like that, there's a good chance that it doesn't matter, so you can just forget about it. But if you can figure out its meaning from the context, then that's good. So let's try to figure out its meaning. Okay, narwhal means corpse whale. Corpse, a corpse is a dead body. Okay, so it doesn't look very good. See here it says, it has earned its name because of its mottled dark gray color. Okay, that means the narwhal must look like a corpse. So mottled must mean something to do with the animal's skin. Okay, it's a dark gray color. I don't know, mottled, it must mean like it's sort of, you know, a person's dead body, the color is sort of uneven. So, you know, one part of a dead person's skin might be sort of white, another might be sort of pink. It's not even. So I'm guessing that's what it means here. Okay, but like I said, it probably doesn't matter, so we can just forget it. But we know it has something to do with the physical appearance of the animal. Okay, so now one of our questions asked this. Narwhals are also referred to as death-like. Death-like. Well, we have our answer right here. Corpse means a dead body. So we pick paragraph A. So the answer to 2 is paragraph A. Okay, so we keep reading our paragraph. Narwhals share physical characteristics with beluga whales, having similar shape and size. We can stop again. We have another answer. Question 9. Narwhal's physical characteristics are also observed in other whale groups. Yes, in beluga whales. Okay, so also paragraph A. Okay, there's a lot of answers from paragraph A. Okay, so let's keep reading. Having similar shape and size. Okay, both species lack dorsal fins. Dorsal means on your back. A dorsal fin, you know, like a shark? A shark has a dorsal fin that sticks out of the water when it's swimming. So that's why you know a shark is coming, because you can see its fin out of the water. But these animals, the narwhals, they don't have dorsal fins, okay? They have short beaks. Beaks are like their mouth and nose area, and rounded heads, and a thick layer of blubber to adapt to glacial conditions. Glacial means really cold, and blubber is fat, is a whale's fat. So sometimes in English, we joke about fat people having lots of blubber, okay? But actually blubber is the fat of a whale, not a human. We just sometimes joke about that. Okay, so now we can move on to paragraph B. The narwhal's distinctive characteristic lies in the presence of a long 2.5 meter spiraling tusk that protrudes from the male's foreheads, resembling a unicorn. Okay, protrudes means comes out of. 2.5 meter spiraling tusk. That's a long tusk. Okay, a tusk is the horn, right, that comes out of the whale's forehead. 2.5 meters, that's like 8 feet. That's long. Imagine getting skewered with the unicorns or with the whale's tusk. 8 feet. That would be really dangerous to see one of these creatures. I wonder if they're aggressive or if they're friendly. Hopefully they're friendly. Okay, the horn-like formation, however, is a long left tooth. The right tooth remains embedded in the skull and measures roughly 30 centimeters. Female tusks have a more regularly defined morphology. Hey, what does this word mean, morphology? Again, it's a pretty big word, so let's just forget about it and move on. They are much shorter, straighter, and do not collect as much algae on the surface, thus appearing whiter. Okay, so the female's tusks are whiter than the male tusks. That was one of our questions, wasn't it? There are physical differences between narwhal males and females. Yes, there are. Okay, so we choose paragraph B. Okay, let's keep reading. So, paragraph C. For hundreds of years, the purpose of the tusk on the unicorn whale has puzzled scientists and local Aboriginal elders alike. A northern Aboriginal legend explains the narwhal's tusk was created when a woman shooting with a harpoon rope was dragged into the ocean after the harpoon had struck a large narwhal whale. She then was transformed into a narwhal herself, and her hair, which was long and twisted, became the characteristic of the spiral tusk. Okay, so what is this talking about? This is talking about Aboriginal legend. Okay, so that was one of our questions, right? Narwhal whales are connected to Canadian Aboriginal folklore. Yes, they are. So we put paragraph C and we move on. Okay, so let's keep reading paragraph C. In academic circles, the tusk remains an evolutionary mystery that defies many of the known principles of mammalian teeth. Okay, preliminary studies suggest the tusk... Wait a minute, now, look at this. Defies the evolutionary mystery that defies many of the principles. Was that one of our questions? I think that was one of our questions. There are aspects of narwhal's anatomy that remain unexplained. Yes, it's a mystery. It said it's a mystery, right? So that's what unexplained means. So we choose paragraph C. So mammalian teeth. Mammalian means a mammal. Humans are mammals. Elephants are mammals. Birds are not mammals. Okay. Preliminary studies suggest the tusk enables whales to determine salinity levels and allows them to detect food in their environment. Salinity levels means the amount of salt in the water. Okay, I guess they can tell how salty the water is. Okay, so now let's move on to paragraph D. So narwhal behavior also intrigues researchers. Males frequently engage in episodes of rubbing their tusks together, or tusking, for as yet unknown reasons. The same behavior is not observed in the female counterparts, or between females and males. Some studies theorize about the possibility of these being mating behaviors aimed at displaying genetic superiority. Okay, so do we have a question about this? I think so. Narwhals present puzzling social interactions. Puzzling means we don't know. We don't understand why they do what they do. Social interactions means the way they interact with each other. Remember, it said males rub their tusks together. Why do they do that? Females don't do that. Males and females don't do that with each other. It's just two males that do that. That's a bit weird. Okay, so yeah, so the answer is paragraph D. Okay, let's keep reading. Support for such a theory, however, has proved scarce since, unlike other mammalian species, the behavior is not aggressive. Narwhals are a migratory species. In an attempt to learn about their migration patterns and social behavior, their populations are being observed and recorded through satellite tracking conducted by scientists in Canada and Greenland. Remember, we had a question about something international or other countries or something. Yeah, different countries are documenting narwhal behavior patterns. Yes, Canada and Greenland are both documenting their patterns. So we put paragraph D. Okay, are we done? Yeah, but we have one question that is unanswered. Okay, what is the question? There is a sound understanding of narwhal's mating behavior. Did we read that in the passage? Well, there was this. It says, some studies theorize about the possibility of these being mating behaviors aimed at displaying genetic superiority. Okay, theorize. So what does the question say? There is a sound understanding. Sound understanding means a very good understanding, a concrete understanding. Well, that's not theorizing, okay? They're different. So there is no information about this. So we put paragraph E, which isn't a paragraph. It's just, it means it's nowhere in the passage. Okay, so then we're done. Now, I think the biggest problem people will have in this question is the time. Okay, you only have 9 minutes to answer 9 questions. Do you think you could do it? It's a bit tricky, especially if you're a slow reader like I am. Okay, I hope you're not as slow as me. I'm a pretty slow reader. I think a good way to do it is to do like what we did, to try to answer the ones you can, okay, or the ones that that you remember when you're reading the passage, and you remember which ones, and you can pick the right paragraph. But there might be a few at the end that are still blank, that you haven't answered yet. Okay, so how should you answer these if you're out of time? Well, then you just need to guess, right? I mean, it would be nice if you had enough time, you could go back and try to figure out what the answer was. But if you're out of time, then you just need to guess. So how would you guess here? Let's see. We have 2 A's already. We have 2 D's. We have a B, a C, and an E. So what is the chances of these? Which letter would you guess? Well, I wouldn't guess E because E means that it's nowhere in the passage. So there's probably only going to be 1 E, maybe 2 E's. But I would either guess B or C because we only have one of those each. So I think one of these is going to be B and the other one is going to be C, but I'm not sure which one is which. So I'm just going to put B for both of them and hope that I get at least one of them right. I don't know. Is that what you would do in this situation? That's what I would do. And hey, I want to know, what is the best way to improve reading speed and comprehension? I want you to think about this question. What is the best way to improve a person's reading speed and their comprehension? Because both of these, speed and comprehension, are really important in this question. So in your English learning so far, what have you done to improve your reading? Let me know. Give me some tips down there in the comments, and I'll see you over in the next episode of Mad English TV. Take care.